It's a solid coffer bar, which has been subjected to these energy beams that John Hutchison has used. This is a beam that's held for NIST at the World Trade Center. How can that have come from a collapse? It's one of the ones that survived. Obviously, it didn't turn to dust. As most of the buildings turned to dust, but not all of it, as we know. Not all of it turned to dust, just most of it. So we've got this horseshoe shape here, pretty clear comparison, I think. This is an aluminium bar. John Hutchison's got 500 pounds of metal samples displaying anomalous effects like this, which appear to be the result of heat, but other factors about them show that it can't have been heat. This is all peeled back in layers, lamination effect. Then we've got this steel beam was rolled up here. So what can cause all this sort of damage? And then look at this. Got another upside down car. This is another experiment John Hutchison does with his energy beams at various frequencies and his 2 tons of equipment, which have to be carefully set up. You can't just sort of set it up, touch it on, and it works. This has took him 10 years to get things to do this. He started off with a very marginal effect, which he only saw 10% of the time, and then he gradually worked out how to tweak it to produce it 100% of the time. You'll see what happens to this can. It flexes in the middle slightly. We have got some better videos than this, actually. These have been filmed by many TV companies, not just John. I say many, probably about 5 or 6. With a lot of other evidence that the Hutchison effect is real. So there it goes. He levitates things. He's done it with a 70-pound cannonball as well. Now, looking at the hazmat truck picture from before, we see this damage on the metal. This is a Red Bull can that's being subjected to the same energy beams to see what would happen to it. You can see the flared metal at home, quite similar.
So I came down, I was across the street, and I picked up the camera just out of habit. And something in the back of my mind said, run, run, run. And never in 20 years of shooting in New York have I run from an assignment. But something in the back of my head just said, run. And as I hit the corner of Liberty Street, it was almost being picked up by a tornado, almost being picked up by me. It was like being picked up with the black cloud. That black cloud had substance. It was like night, but it had a solid feel to it. It was like gravel, hot gravel, and just picked me up and tossed me about a block. I just, at 1 second I was running, and the next second I was airborne. And I lost my glasses, I lost my cell phone, I lost my pager, but managed to hold on to both cameras.
But it took you for a block.
I was back at Ground Zero last week and walked the area where I have a pretty good recollection of where I was and where I wound up, and it was just under a city block.
It was this blast of warm air. It wasn't hot. It was warm. And it picked me up and threw me up against the wall of the building I was.
You were picked up off the ground.
Physically picked up off the ground.
Remember an explosion. At that point, I got knocked out. I don't remember anything. Then I got up, and I looked out the window because the windows exploded, and the street below caved in.
More witness testimony. We had David Hansher's testimony there on the video for the Charlie Rose program in October 2001. Michael Macko, I realised I couldn't get out from under the collapse. I dove under an ESU truck that was facing north on the west side of West Street. He knows where he is. I dove under that and waited for the building to come down. When the building did come down, I actually thought I was trapped and the truck was blown off me, pushed off me, I guess. It was not there. At that point, I was just really shocked. And I didn't know what was going on at that point. I don't know. I was really, really shocked. Ray Gavilan. While we were walking, I realised that we only have two people. I see my vehicle, the seats are covered. I've still got my bag. I hold it like a trophy. People like people collect basketballs I haven't touched. Whatever the force was, it was so strong that it went inside my bag. We have these reports in the witness accounts of this force levitating them, doing things to them, pushing them over. Now, of course, a lot of people say, oh, that was just the wind from the towers coming down. Doesn't make any sense, because if you go back to that previous picture, see if I can find it again. No, I've got it on here. But there's a picture there where you see the fire trucks are upside down, and there's trees in the background with all the leaves on. So if it's a strong wind, why didn't it blow all the leaves off the trees? On and on. Rust effects, we saw this picture before. This is one of John Hutchison's stainless steel beams, which has rust on it. The results of his experiments rust metal under certain conditions. Ongoing effects. This is something I filmed. This will be up. It's not that interesting, because basically I caught them hosing down a cable. We could see this was taken on 17th of Jan 2008. They're still hosing down the site at Ground Zero. The only thing that's been rebuilt, which I think you can just see the corner of there, is Building 7. The rest of the main World Trade Center site, there's no real building on there since 9/11. We think we know the reason for that. It's to do with this. This is a Bankers Trust or Deutsche Bank building. It's opposite World Trade Center 1, or World Trade Center 1 was. Now you'd think that this steel section here, initially a quick glance at this picture, had caused this damage, but if you look at this carefully, you'll see that this is actually bent outwards. So how could this have blasted across and then come back out? It doesn't really make a lot of sense. How can it have had so much energy, done all this damage, yet it was not very damaged itself? It's still fairly intact. It gets stranger when you go inside the building. FEMA reported there was no fire in this building. No fire in this Bankers Trust. It was opposite the World Trade Center. So if there's no fire in this building, what caused that? It actually got holes in there if you look carefully. So how do you get that effect on the steel? This is evidence, folks, from FEMA's own reports that you can download yourself on their FEMA website. Soon after 9/11, we had this sort of damage. They dug out that bit that we saw there, and you can see all the sort of damage here. But they started work to repair it. By 28th of July 2006, it looked like this, and they appear to have repaired a lot of the damage. Okay? But then they announced that the building had a mould infection, and they needed to take it down. They're taking it down piece by piece. And this is part of the deconstructed building. They're down to, I think, between 10 and 15 stories now. When I went to New York in January 2008 to look at Ground Zero, they were down to about 20 stories. But if you look at this beam here, this is rusted. These beams all look okay, but this central one is rusted. This is right where that damage that you saw was with the crinkled beam. It's in a very similar area of the building, apparently. Now, we raised this issue because we went on to Ambrose Lane to promote a separate time. We did actually get on his local program in Washington, D.C. I've got a DVD of this whole program. We did 2 one-hour programs, and I've made that into a DVD with pictures and stuff. It's called The Hutchison Effect in 9/11. And this is what we discussed.
One of the very interesting things that I filmed was a hosing down of a cable from a crane with a big fire hose. And it wasn't just like a squirt. It was, quite a big gush of water over a few tens of seconds.
And the cable was dangling from a big crane. It wasn't laying on the ground. It was just straight dangling.
Mm. So, you know, what would be your comments on all of that, John?
Well, it seems that if that's what's going on there, it seems like there's some kind of infection of some type or something unusual happening there. Because Judy's walking around there and getting sore throats. There's some kind of reaction or chemical reaction going on there.
Right, and Bankers Trust, as we know, had that big gash in the front, which they repaired, and then they started taking the building apart. Why would they repair it and then take the building apart? And they're still working on taking the building apart while we were there. They probably have about half of it gone. It's about 20 stories left. But there's, with the beams they replaced the damaged ones with, the missing, you know, there's just a void that had been in the middle of the building. There's a tremendous amount of rust on those brand new beams that were used to replace the old ones with.
That's not good. That means there's a reaction in the steel or in the ground there that's causing